Hello and welcome to the Fat Boss Guide to Gul'dan in the Nighthold.
So well done, you finally made it to the last boss, and what a boss he is.
Yes.
This guy is no joke. Well, phase one's a bit of a joke, but the other two phases certainly not. Throughout the fight, there are very strict movement and coordination-based requirements, as well as a pretty tough DPS requirement in phase three. And the entire raid really needs to know exactly how every mechanic works, because almost every mechanic will hit them. And if a single player messes up, it's very unlikely they're going to make the requirements, and as a result, you're going to wipe. But before we go into details about phase 1, let's talk about the extra action buttons you get first. So in both phase 1 and 2, every single player in your raid will get an additional ability through the use of your extra action button. This extra spell that everyone gets will help you deal with certain abilities and certain overlaps. And what ability you get actually depends on what role you're playing. Tanks, you get Resonant Barrier, which absorbs all incoming damage for 6 seconds, so this really helps with mechanics that would otherwise one-shot you. For your healers, you get Scattering Field. This will place a Dispriest-style bubble around you that will absorb 50% of all fire damage taken by all players within the bubble. However, it's capped out at a very, very small amount. So although this seems pretty good at first glance, really it's not that strong, and instead of helping you like completely negate mechanics, it just slightly takes the edge off it. And for DPS, you get Time Dilation. This gives you a 10 second buff which increases your casting, movement speed and attack speed by 30%, while also decreasing your cooldowns by 30% and causing your periodic effects to occur 30% faster. So essentially it's a mini Bloodlust. You'll need to use this ability to help burst down certain enemies throughout the phases, and you'll actually need to time it carefully because any fire damage that you take while this ability is up will simply just remove the buff and you'll have to wait until it's back up again. So with that out of the way, let's talk about phase 1.
Now during phase 1 you'll be fighting Gul'dan for a short time before he goes immune after summoning 3 mini-bosses. Throughout this phase he'll be throwing 2 different spells at you. One of these is Liquid Hellfire. He'll mark a location of a random range player and throw an orb of fire at it, dealing a large amount of fire damage to the entire raid. This damage drops off of distance, so moving away from the orb will help you survive the damage. However, if you just stack on top of healers and they use their scattering field here, it will help mitigate a large portion of the damage if you use multiple of them at once. However, in order to cover every single Liquid Hellfire, you will need to split your healers into 2 sets and have them take turns using their extra action button, as the cooldown is longer than the frequency in which the Hellfires come in. The other thing he'll be casting on the raid is Feller Flux. He will target a player and send out a huge beam of fire, which deals a large amount of ticking fire damage to anyone who stands within it. However, this ability has a charge-up time, and Gul'dan will not change the direction of the beam after he has chosen which direction to cast it. So this gives you more than enough time to see where it is going and move out of the way of it before it even comes in. Now the way he summons his mini-bosses is through the use of his Hand of Gul'dan spell. This will mark an area on the floor which will then explode, dealing a large amount of damage to anyone who stands inside it, so you want to move out of the circle and then get ready to switch to the mini-bosses that appear from it. Now these mini-bosses do come in a certain order, and first off you'll have Fel Lord Kura's Mao. You want to drag him on top of Gul'dan and cleave down both of them whilst you wait for the second mini-boss to spawn. Fel Lord himself will cast Shatter Essence on the tank. This cast deals an absolutely huge amount of damage to the tank, easily enough to one-shot them, so the tank who is targeted by this ability wants to make sure that they use Resonance Barrier to survive the hit. Now due to the long cooldown on Resonance Barrier, the other tank will then need to taunt, so if the ability is cast again, the new tank can use Resonance Barrier on it instead. And by the time the third one comes in, he should definitely be dead. Now on Heroic, the Fel Lord will spawn rumbly green patches that will erupt into Fel Obelisks. These will deal damage and stun any player who is caught out by them, so you just gotta make sure you don't get caught, as you really need high output in this phase to get through it cleanly. Now you do not want to use cooldowns on either Gul'dan or the Fel Lord, instead you want to use them as well as your Time Dilation when the next mini-boss spawns, which is Inquisitor Vethrys. You need to nuke him down before he casts his Gaze of Vethrys, because this will spawn eyes around the location of random players, and these eyes will rotate on the spot while sending out a beam which will do a large amount of damage to anyone nearby. The reason this ability is so dangerous is that the eyes just simply take up space, and they'll last for the rest of phase 1, really limiting the room that you have to play with. However, any eyes that do go through, it's not the end of the world because they will be removed when you enter phase 2. Apart from this, he'll just spam a blast on the tank which will do a moderate amount of shadow damage to them, and on Heroic he will apply Drain to players. This is a dispellable dot that will cause the Inquisitor to be healed for a large portion of the damage it deals. So healers really need to quickly dispel these, not only to reduce the incoming raid damage, but also to allow the Inquisitor to die off quicker. Now he can also teleport around the room with Shadow Blink. This didn't happen in any of our pulls as he dies way before this point, but if he does teleport, you just gotta make sure that everyone goes to him to finish him off. Now whilst you're nuking down this Inquisitor, the last mini-boss will spawn, which is the Trapper. You want to stack him up underneath the Inquisitor and just cleave onto him. On Heroic, he will spawn green patches of Anguish Spirits, which will explode, dealing damage to players in the area. Just make sure you move out of them.
So as a quick phase summary, once the Inquisitor is dead, you want to finish off the Foe Lord and then finally the Trapper, whilst of course dodging the Feliflux Beam, as well as stacking up with inside the healing shields for the Liquid Hellfire. Once all three mini-bosses are dead, Gul'dan will do some RP for a bit, destroy the walls of the encounter area, and knock everyone back at the exact same time. You'll want to make sure that you stand very close to him while this is all going on, because if you fall off the encounter area, you will instantly die. And this is the point where phase 2 will begin. Now in this phase, you'll get to fight Gul'dan directly, and over the course of the phase, his abilities will become empowered. And there are 4 abilities that the raid needs to deal with, and 1 additional ability that the tanks need to worry about. All these abilities have set timers, however these timers seem to be a little bit messed up at the moment, because as the boss starts to empower them, it appears that their timers slightly reset, but the strategy that you decide to use for every single ability can be used throughout the phase. There is, however, some key overlap points. But before we go into details about that, let's talk about the abilities themselves first. So the way that we deal with the boss in this phase is that we tank him directly in the middle and have our range stacked slightly behind him, just outside of melee range. Being stacked really helps with the Bonds of Fel. This is a debuff that is placed on 3 players, one of which is always your main tank, one is on a random healer, and then one will be on a random DPS. This debuff just deals ticking damage and slows the target. And the only way of removing this debuff is by moving away from the initial location where you received it. When you move far enough, your bonds will break, but you'll do a huge amount of damage to yourself and anyone within 5 yards, but this damage is split. So if you solo it, you're instantly going to die without an immunity, and instead, you need people to stand on top of you. Having your entire raid stacked on a single location, which we pretty much are at this point, we can just split the damage between everyone, and it feels like the bonds weren't even there in the first place. Just make sure, tanks, as one of you is breaking your bonds, the other one taunts, because you don't want the boss to move on top of the raid, and you'll understand why when we talk about the tank ability in a moment. Being stacked does, however, have a slight downside, because in this phase, you do have Liquid Hellfire. We found that using this strategy, even if the Liquid Hellfire spawns directly underneath your feet, you still don't die. You take an absolute shit ton of damage, but you still don't die, and this can be reduced even further by using the healer shields. Typically, as soon as the Liquid Hellfire would come in, we'd move as far away from the epicenter as we possibly could, which was usually anywhere between 5 and 10 yards. We'd use healer shields and we'd use healing cooldowns. In a smaller raid size with not that many healing cooldowns available, it's probably not a good idea to be stacked the entire time, and instead we recommend that you're loosely spread. But providing you keep an eye on your timers, there's nothing preventing you from being spread for every single Liquid Hellfire and being stacked for every single bond. And being spread has extra advantages, especially when it comes down to the Eyes of Gul'dan. When the boss casts this ability, he'll spawn 4 IADs that will spread out around him and will begin to channel a beam on random players. This beam does a huge amount of damage to that player, as well as all players within 8 yards of them. And this beam typically will only ever target ranged players. So the moment the eyes spawn, it's very important that the range immediately spread out or pre-spread. You'll then want everyone in your raid, including your melee DPS, swap to them and kill them off as soon as you possibly can. Because while they're up, not only will they channel these beams, but they will also duplicate themselves, spawning more eyes, meaning more beams, meaning more damage. A little note for your DPS, these eyes actually deal shadow damage, so feel free to use time dilation to get them down as soon as you possibly can, because you won't lose your buff. It's a good idea to use it here, get them out of the fight as soon as you possibly can. Also in this phase, Gul'dan will still be casting his Hand of Gul'dan, but instead of spawning the same mini-bosses that you saw in phase 1, it will now just spawn a Dreadlord. These Dreadlords need to be picked up by your off tank and brought underneath the boss while everybody switches to it and nukes it down as soon as they possibly can. This guy isn't very complicated, he'll cast one single ability, which is Carry On Wave. If this cast goes off, you'll take a huge amount of damage and be stunned for a very, very long period of time. If this cast goes off, it's more or less a wipe. So it's very, very important that you interrupt it. But don't be too trigger happy, because every time you interrupt him, he'll gain a buff that increases his attack speed and damage by 25%. So as soon as he starts to cast, wait a couple of seconds and then interrupt it. By interrupting him at the latest point, that's just going to save a hell of a lot of healer mana, because this guy already hits pretty damn hard. And for your tanks, Gul'dan will be casting Felsife, and it's really important you get this down, because he'll also be casting this in phase 3. Now whenever anyone goes within 2 yards of the tank, Gul'dan will cast this ability. This will deal a large amount of damage between the tank and whatever player proc'd the Felsife. At the same time, it will also buff Gul'dan's attack speed by 15% for 10 seconds, and this will stack. To add another layer to this ability, Gul'dan also has an energy bar, and all of this energy is used up whenever he casts Felsive. And for each unit of energy he uses, it increases the damage of Felsive by 5%. And if Gul'dan reaches full energy, he will cast Felsive regardless if the tank has anyone nearby. So you want to force Gul'dan to use this ability often enough so that his energy stays low, but not too often that he gets a stupidly high attack speed. So typically, every 12 seconds or so, you want your tanks to stand on top of each other, proc the Felsive, and then spread back out, and then repeat that throughout the entire fight. When you are proccing this Felsive, it's probably a good idea to let the other tank know that you're about to do it. You need to communicate between each other, just so you're both on the same page, because there's nothing stopping you from proccing the Felsive when the other tank isn't even ready, and he just gets one shot because he has no active mitigation up. So make sure that you communicate before you do it. But as the ability can be procced by anyone, it's vital that melee don't ever go near the tanks. This is the reason why they have a tank taunts when the fell bonds are going on, because you can't just proc fell scythe all over the melee. They will definitely get one shot. So melee keep away from the tanks, and tanks taunt off each other when the fell bonds come in, just to make fell scythe safe. So there are all the five abilities in this phase. However, like we said at the start, some of them become empowered. At 85%, it'll empower his bonds of fell. When the empower bonds are applied, they'll knock their targets way back and then apply the bonds once they've landed. The bonds will also deal more damage and slow you more. You'll want to make sure that you have all players close to the boss so that when the knockback comes in, you'll still land on the platform. And you want to be stacked up so you land close together. All ranged players then must go out and soak the two bonds on the non-tank targets. To make things cleaner, if the bond player can use immunity to solo soak the bonds, such as Bubble or Turtle or something like that, then they probably should. As for the tank, he's going to be knocked onto the other side of the room. When this happens, it's important that the other tank taunts to keep Gul'dan in position. We then have our tanks use a very large damage reduction, an immunity, or their extra action button so they can solo soak their own bond. We set up in such a way so if one of our tanks definitely can't solo soak one of the next bonds, we have the other tank taunt instead. No matter what tank setup you have, one of them will always be able to solo soak one of their bonds. But if not, maybe you've messed up a cooldown somewhere, you've wasted one, then get your raid to come and assist you instead. At 70% health, he'll empower his liquid hellfire. This will cause it to deal slightly more damage and also leave a patch of fire on the ground that lasts for 3 minutes or until phase 3 starts. You should deal with this the exact same way that you've dealt with all of your other hellfires up to this point, but as you can see, we just stand in the exact same location, take the burst of damage, and then just sidestep it, waiting for the next one to come in. Just make sure that when it's about to come in, you don't want to have any ranged DPS in the middle of the room, because this could potentially cause the liquid hellfire to spawn on top of melee, which is obviously very, very bad. And again, for most liquid hellfires that do come in, we usually have some form of healing cooldown up. Now at 55%, he'll begin to empower his Eyes of Gul'dan. This will cause them to form into one big eye. This big eye works the exact same as the little ones, except he now deals fire damage, so players hit by his beams will lose their time dilation, but he just deals so much more damage now. If you're stacked up when these beams go off, it will almost certainly one-shot you, so you need to make sure that you're pre-spread when the eye spawns. The eye also now has a threat table, so when it does spawn, it's a really great idea for your tanks to land something on it, just to bring it into melee so it stays in position for melee to cleave onto it. Which really is vital, because this eye will also duplicate, and if you have two of them up, things go bad fast. And that's everything that you need to know for phase 2 in terms of how the individual abilities work, but do keep in mind that sometimes these abilities overlap. There are points where you will have liquid hellfire, and then almost immediately afterwards, eyes will spawn. In the situation where you're completely stacked like we do because we're too lazy to move out, the immediate eye damage that comes afterwards will almost certainly cause problems, especially if you're not using a healing cooldown. To add on top of that, there are moments where you'll get liquid hellfire, and then immediately you'll get the empowered bonds. If you're spread super far out and you don't move back in ready for the bonds, you're just going to fly off the edge of the platform. So it's vital that you keep an eye on your timers, and as you progress this phase, you'll get to a point where you don't even need to look at your timers anymore, because the flow of the fight, it's very similar to fights like Manoroth, where you know exactly what's coming next, just because it's so repetitive. But in terms of positioning for this phase, as you can see, we spend almost all of our time within this inner circle, only spreading for eyes, and then we move immediately back in. We're stacked for almost this entire phase. But once you have got the hang of it, and you have got over those overlap points, eventually you'll get the boss to 40% health, and this is when he'll transition into his last phase.
Then when he starts his transition, he will briefly go immune into the middle of the room and then emerge in an empowered form. A gust of wind will push all players towards one side of the platform, so you want to be in the middle of the room and run against this pushback to avoid falling off. He will then remove all of your extra action buttons and the phase will begin. If you pop time dilation just before he removes them, you do get to keep the buff for the first like 10 seconds or so going into phase 3, which is pretty nice because the damage requirement in this phase is very high. Now this phase is all about dealing with the abilities the boss throws at you quickly and efficiently. Tanks, you want to drag the boss over to one side of the platform while still dealing with the boss's failsafe in the same way that you did in phase 2, by stacking every 12 seconds or so. The raid wants to be spread out on one side of the room in small raid sizes, or on two sides of the room in larger raid sizes. This is so you can be spread 8 yards for the empowered Eye of Gul'dan that spawns. This ad, just like in the last phase, needs to be killed off as soon as possible, except in this phase there's a ton more raid damage going out and this eye does not help you at all. DPS should really try and save cooldowns for each time an eye spawns, including using things like Bloodlust on the very first eye that appears. If tanks can face the boss towards the middle of the room, it will place the eye in a much better position when it spawns, allowing all players to easily be in range of it and easily get to it straight away. The range being spread also helps with a new ability in this phase, which is Flames of Sargeras, and this is the number one thing that is going to wipe your raid in this phase, so you definitely need to master it. This is a debuff applied to multiple people throughout this phase, and after 3 seconds, these players will start dealing ticking damage to themselves and anyone within 8 yards of them. Each time anyone takes damage from this ability, a patch of fire will spawn underneath them shortly afterwards. So you need to move quickly away from the raid and place the fire out of harm's way. As a ranged player, you want to move away from the boss with this debuff, place the fire, and then return. And as a melee, you want to move towards the edges of the encounter area, place the debuff over there, and then come back. And as a tank, you want the other tank to taunt whilst you place your fire at the edges of the room. Now, whilst placing this debuff, you can severely limit the amount of space the fire takes up by controlling your movement. As the fire doesn't spawn immediately, you want the debuff to tick twice, then move to the edge of the fire patch that just spawned, and then let the remainder of the debuff time out. This will create 2 patches of stacked up fire, rather than 4 spread out patches of fire. And if you wanted to improve that further, you could just move out of the raid, of course, and then just stand there and have all 4 patches spawn in one single location. You will need to have some form of personal damage reduction at this point, or at least a healer spot healing you just so you can survive the ticking damage and the fire damage underneath you, but this will once again increase the amount of space that you have and just keep the area clear. This entire phase is all about controlling where this fire is placed, and as long as you can deal with this successfully, you'll find this phase a hell of a lot easier. Now throughout this phase, Gul'dan will be applying Soul Siphon to players. This debuff is just simply a healing absorption shield, and of course, healers need to top them up to make sure that those players can actually receive healing when large damage is going out onto the raid. Each time he applies these debuffs, he'll also place souls into the well in the middle of the room. The souls in the middle of this well must be soaked before the boss casts Black Harvest. This will do an enormous amount of raid-wide damage, plus extra damage per soul that is inside that well. You will need to have healing cooldowns for each Black Harvest, and even then it's sketchy. And that's without any souls in the well at all. So to make sure that the well is soulless, you need to have players stand within it. This will cause them to take a small amount of ticking damage, and for every soul that they remove from the well, they will gain a 3-minute dot which stacks. Because of this dot, you will need to make sure that you rotate players in to soak, and this way the dot will not get too high on any given player. You also do not want to soak in the middle of the well whilst Flame of Sargeras are being placed on players, as the fire might spawn within the well, or when the Eye of Gul'dan is up, as the healers won't be able to top up the people in the well whilst healing the players targeted by the beams. It is during the downtime between these abilities that you need to ensure that the well is being emptied. Now the last ability the boss will do is Storm of the Destroyer. This is a series of 4 explosions which are blasted out from Gul'dan's position. These explosions will grow bigger and gain more damage over the course of this ability, so you will need to make sure that Gul'dan is on one side of the room, and then as soon as the cast starts, have everyone run over to the other side of the room to avoid damage. The explosions will clean up the room by removing any fire patches on the ground, and after the cast, he will teleport to the tank and the fight somewhat cycles from there. Now during these explosions, the boss can, and most likely will, apply Flame of Sargeras to people. These people need to act very, very quickly and try and place the fires near the incoming explosions so that the fire that spawns from them can be cleared immediately. Another example of a bad crossover point is after the second Storm of the Destroyer. Before he decides to teleport, he will summon an Eye of Gul'dan. This is one of the toughest overlaps in the entire fight, as the entire raid is on the other side of the room, meaning that they cannot get to the eye straight away. You should use a mass movement speed increase and have all DPS run over there and nuke this eye. And this is a perfect time to have cooldowns up, even if it's just a second pot. Once you kill this eye, you should be relatively in the clear, as the boss will just spawn one more eye shortly afterwards, and then the fight somewhat slows down from there as he kind of decides, like, towards the last 5-10% of his health, not ready to do that much at all.
Yeah, it feels like all the abilities that he was supposed to do in the fight in this last phase, he decides to use right at the very start.
Yeah.
And it's just complete chaos. You get all these debuffs coming out, as well as having to put the fires out the raid, as well as moving from one side to the other, and the eye. There's all these things going on, and then suddenly he's like, okay, I'm going to take a rest now, while you just pummel my face.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a little bit odd, but it's a crazy last phase. But again, it's all about those fire placements. If you can get those fires in really decent locations, so you have more room to spread when the actual eye comes in and starts blasting people, especially in larger raid sizes, it makes it so much cleaner. And that probably is where most of your problems will stem with, providing you can deal with the other, to be honest, pretty easy mechanics.
That's it, guys. Thank you so much for watching. If this video did help you out, then make sure you leave a like on it. And if you want to know more about this encounter, or you want to see a phase-by-phase breakdown, or you've forgotten anything, then do go and check out our written guide over on Wowhead. And before we do go, we want to give a big shout out to our supporters over on Patreon. You guys are the best, so thank you so, so much. And, of course, we'll see you all next week with the Mythic Guides. Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching.